It is my great pleasure to introduce Professor Shivakumar Malapaka. So he worked for his PhD in the Max Planck Institute of Plasma Physics and obtained the degree from the Department of Physics and University of Beirut in 2009. He has many postdoctoral experiences in all over the world. And so he joined IIIT Bangalore as an assistant professor in July 2015 and teaching theory and lab courses for the physics course for IMTech. And his scientific work mainly focuses on numerical modeling and simulations of different problems in physics. His main focus is in numerical simulations of hydrodynamics and magnetohydrodynamics, turbulences. So I can say that he has very nice videos in his talk, so I hope you will enjoy it. So welcome, Professor Shiva.
Thank you. Thank you, Amit, for the introduction. Title of the talk, and here is the list of all my collaborators and co-authors in various papers that I will describe and some of the works that I'm going to do in future. So for most of you, the idea of turbulence would be something akin to this. So please focus on that video there. Where a plane is entering into a turbulence. That video where the plane is entering into a turbulence, that's the common experience of many who fly in an aeroplane. And the word turbulence usually rings bell only in those contexts for most of you. Whereas for some others, say, who live in the coastal belt of the Bay of Bengal or in the Arabian Sea, seeing a cyclone of that size which is approaching you will ring bell, and the word turbulence will ring bell, because that system is a turbulent system. The big cyclone is a turbulent system, and it will wreak havoc on the land when it approaches, when it crosses over the land. But in principle, what is turbulence? Turbulence is seen in fluids. It's an unpredictable, undeterministic phenomena covering, say, several range of length scales. If you look at this particular system, the scales that are involved are ranging from few centimeters in the edges to few kilometers of the vortices in that range. Okay. So it's a classical physics problem, and that's how the worst experience of turbulence that can be in a plane. So it's a problem that remains unsolved, and it is one of the clay mathematics problems, and if you can solve this problem completely deterministically, $1 million prize awaits you. And the various approaches to turbulence are theory, experiments, simulations and modeling. I'll show you one experience which scientifically explains how turbulence can be obtained. Okay, so it's a video by Professor Robert W. Stewart. So here they have a tube flow experiment, pipe experiment. They have a high viscous fluid and a low viscous fluid, and they are mixing the two fluids using a pump in a controlled manner and passing it through a pipe, and they have a control on the viscosity. So this is the development of turbulent flow.
Coming the tube will become blurred. People look at this screen in slow motion. We can see that the blurring is resolved into an irregular motion of the surface. The form has become turbulent, and the onset of turbulence in the pipe has revealed itself both in the irregular motion of the fluid stream and in the greatly increased drag in the tube.
Okay. So what Professor Stewart tells us about what is what he terms as turbulence syndrome is that turbulence is, if you want to define a flow as turbulent, it should have disorder, it should mix the ingredients efficiently, and there should be an associated vorticity. So if you look at, say, any of these flows that we have seen now, even in this particular thing, the plane was entering something of this kind, a cyclonic or a weather system, which will have vorticity, which is the curl of velocity. That's why the rotation of this particular, say, structures. And the system will efficiently mix the ingredients present, that is the water and the air layers. That is why the system becomes so much of a, there will be a pressure gradient that will be established and the system becomes turbulent. And further, it is a disorder by itself. And if one has to, the turbulent motions are present everywhere in universe and they are associated with say magnetic fields as well. So plasma is the fourth state of matter, which is say ions or molecules stripped of their electrons, and so it is a ionic matter in principle, and it's a conducting fluid. So when a electrically conducting fluid moves, it generates currents. So that is it generates magnetic fields around it. So that is the reason why these plasma will also be associated with say magnetic fields. And 99% of the known universe, or little about that fraction, is known to be plasma. And because of the presence of magnetic field and the and because of the flow of this particular material, what we term as plasma, there will be a huge magnetic fields setting up. So the systems are more complex, and so the best example of a say such a system, the video here shows a huge coronal mass ejection coming out of sun, which is a big plasma bowl by itself. There is a core which is radiating. You see that sun is a huge bowl of plasma, and the coronal mass ejection coming out of the sun, this particular ejection that is coming is called a coronal mass ejection. And this ejection can actually cause a radio blackouts on Earth, because this particular system is associated with a lot of magnetic field and ions that can, and the particles that this particular ejection has. That's the thing I could not understand. Where is it coming from? Okay, I cannot talk on top of it. Okay, thankfully. So what you just saw is called a coronal mass ejection. And this particular picture was, as you see, it was made by NASA. And the satellite is looking at the sun when at a particular point in time, a large amount of plasma as a rope came out of it. It is called a coronal mass ejection. And those mass ejections, if they come in the direction of the sun, of the Earth, they create radio blackouts. In 1983, in Canada, the whole of the power grid went blank because of such an event. And until then, people did not even knew that sun can cause such a destruction to the systems on Earth. The telecommunication and electrical systems can become, some kind of static. They can obtain static magnetic field because of the ions that enter through that particular ejection and can cause radio blackouts and, say, power blackouts. So this is what happens. The ejection is coming towards the Earth, and if it comes into the Earth's atmosphere, somewhere in Earth, such a thing can happen. And the picture here shows the development of some scales, from small scale structures to large scales, which I will talk about. And to understand how these structures can be formed, we need to study a combination of Maxwell's equations with the fluid equations. That's what we will do next. So there are two sets of equations here. First, hydrodynamic equation, that is the classical Navier-Stokes, with the assumption that we are only looking at a single fluid, and we are looking at a fluid that is completely isotropic and homogeneous, and we are not considering the compressibility effects. So we are looking at only the constant density system. Here, the U here represents velocity, and this particular function, advection derivative as it is called, will be one of the important parameters that will create all the havoc in the system that we study. And the dissipation term with a eta here is the diffusion term, and its constant, which is a diffusion constant, kinematic viscosity as it is called, and the pressure is present as the term on the RHS. Here, actually, the Navier-Stokes equation is such that you can add any force term to it and work on the system. So there are people who work on adding temperature to it, and I add actually magnetic field to this system. So that particular system will look that way. So on the right hand side, I have added the effect of magnetic field. So you can see there, the magnetic field is coming in as a B is the magnetic field, and it is coming as a B cross B, del cross B. And in order to, once you introduce a field here, you have to solve for that field. So you have a induction equation which solves for the magnetic field effects. And because the fields are not separated by themselves, there is a coupling here. That is the Lorentz force term. So this is the Lorentz force term, and this is the induction equation. And here, magnetic field also diffuses. So you have a magnetic diffusivity term. And these are the Laplacians, which are the second order derivatives. And you have to work with this particular system is, say, the generic form. But you can work with you have to work with non-dimensionalized forms, because you want to, say, study any system that is given to you. So you may have to, say, work with a system which has just, say, millimeters to kilometer scales, or in terms of astronomy, there can be, say, terms of, like, say, kilometers to megaparsec scales. So anything one has to solve using the same equation. So you have to non-dimensionalize the equations. And the pressure term there is actually, when you take the curl of this particular equation, the pressure term vanishes, and you get an equation of this form, which is the vorticity equation. And this is the equation with which is more comfortable to work with, nothing specific other than that. And then you transform, then there is a the parameters, the there is a change in the parameters of the dimensionless parameters. Mu, they are now becoming mu cap and eta cap. Here we define what are known as Reynolds numbers. So the if you take the kinematic viscosity, you can define what is known as the normal Reynolds number, which is specific to a characteristic length scale and a characteristic velocity scale, velocity. And similarly, you can define a magnetic Reynolds number with a specific magnetic length scale specific to magnetic fields and velocities, and this is the magnetic diffusivity. These are the what you call functional forms with which we work on. And now if you transform these equations into Fourier domain, that is where the simulations are done usually. The reason being that Fourier domain helps us to work with the periodic boundary conditions. That's the major advantage. And and you can simulate those Fourier modes easily. So those are the two primary advantages why one would go to try to use Fourier transforms. Although some people do use other methods like Lagrangian, Bessel to solve these equations. They are called fully spectral methods. I use what is known as pseudo-spectral method, and Fourier analysis is better suited for that. And so the reason why, another important reason why we have to look for Fourier domains is it also helps us to understand how scales are created. So for example, look at a convolution integral, which is defined this way. So now you can also write this convolution integral. Now P, K are two, let us assume P and K are two scales. Now you can write this equation in terms of a double integral with an interaction parameter, say Q in it. And which and now these three scales, K, P, Q, if they form a triangle, that means K plus P plus Q is equal to zero. Each time such an interaction happens, a convolution happens, it will create a new scale. So the generation of scales, which is seen in turbulence, can be understood with the ideas of the convolution integral, which will be present in the these tildes here represent convolution integrals. There are three convolution integrals here. And these integrals help you build the scales. I'll come to that in the next slide, what I meant by scale generations. And there is another important parameter called magnetic Prandtl number, which is the ratio of magnetic Reynolds number by kinetic Reynolds number. And this is the parameter which I am interested in now in my current work. But those equations, if solved plainly, will result in some flows. But to understand those turbulent flows, it has been, as I already mentioned, it is an unsolved problem and you cannot solve it completely. So there are what are known as phenomenologies. So there are, say, two major phenomenologies, one which works with structures and one which works with waves. The one I am interested in is the one with which is having structures in it. So let us assume that there are several scales in the system. So let us assume that the largest scale is where you inject energy into the system. And as you see, when a cyclone approaches land, it will break down into pieces and then vanish. So exactly that is the idea here, that is assume that this is the largest vortex which got energized from the sea and the pressure differences. And now it is coming onto the land, breaking up and vanishing. Okay. So that is the injection scale, where it is at the largest scale the energy is getting injected into the system. Here there are some intermittent scales where the flux of energy is moving and then the flux dissipates. And if you look at the same picture in the spectral domain, it will have the following spectrum. There will be the extremely large scales or smallest wave numbers. K is 1 by wave number. So here the energy gets injected. This is the flow of energy, and this is where the energy gets dissipated. Here, you saw these triads in the previous picture. These triads, if they are, say, of equal size, you term the interaction local. But if the triads are very long, as you can see, say, forming a scalene-like triangle, these interactions are called non-local interactions. So the scales present here, that is small scales, are influencing the large scales. That is the idea of showing these large triangles. And when the term cascade that is present here is defined as a moment of any physical quantity moving with constant flux in a regime termed as inertial range. This range, where you see a straight line in the log-log plot of energy versus wave number, is called the inertial range. Here, the dynamics of the system is only dominated by the nonlinear term, independent of the energy injected or the energy dissipated. This area is called the inertial range. And here, if the flux of a physical quantity is constant, then it is shown to be have a cascade, and the cascades can happen in both the directions. So the flux can flow from, say, large scales to small scales, or in some certain physical parameters it can happen the other way as well. That is, it can go from small scales to large scales. So if that happens, it is called inverse cascade. But whenever a system is getting turbulent, it does not, uniform phenomena. It does not happen like every minute or every second or every time interval. The turbulent energy transfer happens in a very bursty-like thing. It is called intermittency. So the structures in the system look like this. If you look at the structures in a periodic domain, they look like this, but these structures hide the phenomena of intermittency. That is, there are some structures which were responsible for the creation of turbulence. But you will be, as of now, there is no one who can say this is the particular structure that can create intermittency. So that particular subject of intermittency is an open area of research. And I will try to convey some ideas which we are trying to understand this. These cascades also happen in the MHD turbulence, magnetohydrodynamic turbulence. That is the turbulence in plasmas, and especially in a quantity called magnetic helicity, which is defined as the volume integral of magnetic vector potential and the magnetic field itself, and it is a measure of linkage and twists of the magnetic field. So the ejection that you saw that came out of the sun was not a straight ejection, but it was if you had looked at it closely, it would have had some kind of a twist with it. That kind of a twist or a link is result of what you call as helicity in the system. And the measure of such linkages, twists and linkages, is by magnetic helicity. It is a ideally conserved quantity when there are no dissipation terms in the system. And in the resistive MHD, that is when there is this magnetic diffusivity, it is just the conserved quantity. It is ideally conserved and just conserved in resistive MHD. And it shows inverse cascade. And it is believed that it is one of the mechanisms through which large-scale magnetic structure can be formation of large-scale magnetic structures in the universe can be understood. It was first shown in a paper by Pouquet et al. In 1976 using an approach called eddy-damped quasi-normal Markovian approximation, where they tried to write the Navier-Stokes equations in terms of four statistical equations and then solve them numerically. And they showed in their paper that if they injected helicity at small scales, the helicity spectrum would move to larger and larger scales as the system evolved. This is what they termed as inverse cascade, and they showed that this particular system has a power law in the inertial range which is to the tune of k power minus 2. And we tried to understand this system in our work and we also got we initiated our system there, somewhere there, and saw the evolution of this particular inverse cascade to larger and larger scales, which I will talk next. But why should say this particular quantity inverse cascade at all? The reason is that mod magnetic helicity is always less than or equal to the term magnetic energy by wave number, which is even less than the total energy by the wave number. So if we consider interaction between two wave numbers P and Q, then the helicity, this particular quantity called the detailed valence quantity, should always lie between the minimum and maximum of the two wave numbers. So this particular value will be, say, movement of this particular value will always be towards the maximum of k, that is this direction, which is towards the larger scales. So that is the idea of say, or why should it go towards the larger scales. Now about intermittency itself, this was the drawing of Leonardo da Vinci on turbulent flows about 500 years ago, and he draws several swirls and wonders why and how these swirls come and vanish. And also he observes that these structures have more or less self-similar, that is they look similar wherever you look, but that's not really true. There are in these self-similar structures some structures which actually bring the turbulence to life. So for example, if you look at a velocity signal from a jet, it may look more or less uniform or self-similar as it is, but if you pass it through a high-pass filter, there will be some bursty behavior, and these are the places where actually the jets go turbulent suddenly. Okay, so that is the idea. That is the idea that is also inherently present inside these structures. And so that particular kind of intermittency is called internal intermittency, as mentioned here. And you have to understand intermittency in the real domain, we use the ideas of say structure functions, kurtosis, PDFs and QR plots, which I will define later. But as far as I know, there are the origin and the nature of intermittency is still an open problem. So for understanding or controlling, if we can at all, this particular feature or phenomena of turbulent flows, we came up with an idea, and that is the next topic of my work. So what we did was we took the classical Navier-Stokes and as we know, the classical Navier-Stokes will have a spectrum of this kind, as I already shown. So now if we try to block say some of the scales there, if we block those scales and work with only larger scales, they are called larger dissimulations, which are also popular. But what we try to do is something different. So let us assume that this is the full three-dimensional Fourier domain space with their modes, which we are looking at a projection on the plane. Now, we randomly remove a certain number of modes. Then the dimensionality of the system reduces. It becomes fractional or fractal. So that is the idea with which we will work now. So this particular idea is not absolutely new. There were a few attempts before, but this, but there was one attempt before by say Dieter Lohse and group, and they did remove certain modes in the system, but their mode removal was more systematic and not random, and that's why their results, although showed the lack of intermittency, were questioned. But there was another paper in two dimensions, two-dimensional turbulence, by Uriel Frisch and his group, where they showed that if you go from a two-dimensional system to 1.5 dimensions, intermittency slowly vanishes. So this was the idea with which we also started our work. So we took the Navier-Stokes equation, and we started decimating the system with a probability of HK, the wave numbers, certain wave numbers. We have no control of the wave numbers, but we have a projection operator which acts on the velocity field and creates a new velocity field of that kind. And we use that equation as shown here. And the properties of this projection operator are that it has Hermitian symmetry and it is also self-adjoint. And the decimation that we do is frozen in time. That means at every time step we do it, but it is not evolving in time. And the inviscid variants are same. That means if there are any conserved quantities in the system, they remain conserved without any trouble. Statistical symmetries that are preserved by Navier-Stokes are also preserved, and we do not introduce any external scales. And I'll show that the flux of energy coming out is constant. And because we are picking out at random the modes, the dynamics is isotropically decimated. So fractal dimension is when you are looking at the system, you remove certain number of modes, then you mean to say, how do you actually see the here the k power df minus 3 is the decimation operator df is removing certain number of modes and creating a fractal dimension which is less than 3. Okay, what we do is that we decide on, the way we do it, it's a pure numerical step. What we do is we decide on to remove a certain percent of modes from the full three-dimensional system. So once we decide on removing, say, 3% of the modes, we plot the spectrum. Okay. And when we plot the spectrum, we see that the spectrum that we get is not fully compensated with the three-dimensional spectrum, but is lying below. Okay. So the percentage of modes removed will, if you increase the number or increase the percentage of modes as you go on, I'll try to come there quickly. Yeah, here. So here, this is the red one is the full three-dimensional spectrum. Okay. So if you remove certain amount of modes, the spectrum has to be compensated with a different k power value. So there you decide, you will be able to decide what dimension you got. I don't have an a priori control on the dimension I get, but I have only one control, that is how many modes I can remove. Yeah, I can actually, so you know, this was main made with trial and error when we identified that what dimensions we got. If we removed about 3% of the modes, we attain 2.999 to the 3 decimals. If we remove about 8%, we get to 2.98. Then if you remove, say, about 12% or so, you get 2.8 and so on. So that is the way we could, when say, see with trial and error what dimensionality we are approaching to. Of course, we also had later proved mathematically how we can get to the dimensionality. But originally, the way we did was that we did it with a trial and error. So the system, we use a pseudo-spectral method. What do you mean by pseudo-spectral method? You work in the Fourier domain, and whenever there is a convolution integral, it becomes a multiplication in the real domain. So you come back and multiply in the real domain and go back to the Fourier domain. That is the idea of pseudo-spectral method. You work on the periodic box so that of length 2 pi, so that you can divide this 2 pi to whatever number of values of your resolution. So you can divide the 2 pi to 512 cube. 2 pi cube to 512 cube, or 1024 or 2048 cube. These are the resolutions we work with. And dealiation is by 2/3 rule. What do you mean by dealiation? When you are trying to work with signals, the two signals should not overlap and create a mixture of signal which is not understood. So you have to keep a distance of at least 2/3 before you can start the next system. Or do you have to filter out that much? I'm not a signal systems guy. So it is the 2/3 rule. It is 2/3, 2/3 truncation. I also work with spherical truncation. That's different in the MHD. So that you can use up to n/2. I mean, or you can go up to k/2 instead of k into 2/3, you can go up to k/2 also. Then the time stepping is using Adams-Bashford scheme. It is for the integration. And we keep the initial condition as the range of shells between 0.7 and 1.7 will be supplied with energy. And the fractal dimensions we obtained were between 2.5 and 3. And these are the parameters. And we saw, we did two types of masking, as it is called. One is static masking. That is, you take a fully developed three-dimensional turbulence and mask it with a certain number of modes. And that will remove certain number of modes. That is called a static mask. Or evolve the system with the mask itself. That is called dynamic mask. So the energy flux in the system is defined as follows. And you can see that the energy flux remains pretty much constant over a very large range of inertial range. And the PDF of energy flux is also shown here. It is more or less Gaussian, that is random. It shows that there is no intermittency, it's random in nature. And the energy Galerkin truncations will conserve the quadratic quantities that are present in the system. And the velocity field, as you go towards the three dimensions, becomes rougher. That is known because three-dimensional systems are intermittent in nature. And if we plot the energy spectrum, These are the various energy spectrum of various runs. This is the kinetic energy. The red being the three-dimensional system, and rest of all are the fractal dimensions. Now, if we compensate these energies, you can see that for the static mask, you had to compensate with a positive dimension that was missing, and for a dynamic mask, you had to do it with a negative minus 5, k power minus 0.5 and k power minus plus 0.5 for a df of 2.5. So this was a new result, which then resulted in a general solution of that kind, where EDK is the fully three-dimensional turbulent system, and k power 5 by 3 is the compensation, what is called a Kolmogorov compensation, and minus 3 plus d is the additional factor that comes into picture when you are working with a fractal dimension of d. So this particular result gave us the idea that if you add or subtract that particular fraction, you will go back to the fully Kolmogorov-like system. But does that result in the... This is the Galerkin truncation, right? Yeah, Galerkin truncation. So, let us look at the three-dimensional spectrum. Okay, so it is the spectrum actual. Okay, one second. Here we can see. So the three-dimensional spectrum. Oh yeah. Okay. Three-dimensional. Actually, this particular kind of a behavior, as far as I know, is because of two factors. One is if we are using hyperviscosity, then there will be accumulation of energy just before the dissipation range. So there will be a bump. Okay, so if you can compensate that, you will see the but in this particular case, when we are working with normal viscosity, this is normal viscosities. So when you are working with normal viscosities, what happens, as I understand, is that as you are reaching towards the dissipation range, okay, the spectral range is here, and then the dealiation cutoff. This is not because of Galerkin, because in MHD I don't see this. K is the wave number. Yeah, very small length scale. Depending on the resolution, 2/3 of that. So if it is 1020. No. It's not a numerical. It is in the dissipation range. So it is to do with dissipation. That much I understand. But exact reason of that bump, I'm still to think. I'll try to get you the answer as soon as possible. I don't have it immediately. But so what we try to do is whether the structures also respond similarly. That is what we wanted to understand. So what we plot are known as moments of velocity. At a given scale plus some characteristic length, So this is the moment of velocity. And if you raise the moments to higher orders, you call them structure functions. And the average averages of these fluctuations are known to show a power law with the characteristic length scale, where zeta p is the structure function constant. So this is the standard method. So we also tried to do with the decimated field. But what we understood was two things, that there are two types of structure functions, longitudinal and transverse. And when you look at the longitudinal structure function of order 2, it matches with what we know and also gets compensated with the formula shown here, where dc is the fractional dimension. But beyond the second order, the structure functions don't, there is no mathematical basis to say that this particular thing is valid. Although they show the behavior that we want. Here we show structure functions of, say, structure function exponents of fourth order. But the structure function behavior is okay, but we don't know the mathematics of this particular thing. Beyond p greater than 2, we have no idea of how this behavior is present. But what we also know from the idea of structure functions is that there is a critical dimension 2.96 up to which you can recover the turbulence behavior. Beyond 2. That is less than 2.96, you cannot get intermittence, turbulent behavior. So this dimension 2.96 is called the critical dimension, where one can see turbulence or no turbulence on both sides of it. This is a important result that we saw. Then we continued our statistical analysis and we plotted the PDFs of these various dimensions that we saw. And we see that the idea of these PDFs is that when there is a pure random process, the PDF is a Gaussian. And when there are intermittent events, the Gaussians will develop tails. So the three-dimensional turbulence is here. And as you go down to smaller and smaller fractions, up to 2.8, the turbulent behavior vanishes intermittent behavior vanishes, and you obtain pure Gaussian-like PDFs. The same is true with kurtosis. You see where the three-dimensional system shows kurtosis of a high value, and as you go down the dimensions, the kurtosis approaches a value of 3, which is the kurtosis of a pure Gaussian, that is equal to 3. And this is true in both the cases, that is in the static mask case as well as the dynamic mask case. So what we also observed was that the static mass case in the spectrum recovers quickly, but structures don't recover. So, and also there is a dependence on Reynolds number. So if we go with higher resolutions, you can obtain larger and larger Reynolds numbers. And if you plot kurtosis per now velocity fluctuations, you can see that reduces the intermittent. If you go to the higher Reynolds numbers, that is the 2048 cube resolutions, the intermittent corrections are reduced and they fall towards the non-intermittent system quickly. Whereas this is 1024 cube simulations of the same dimensionality, and they are having higher intermittent corrections. We also looked at what we call as drag and forcing. The plot here shows the same, the dimensionality and the drag. And we see that drag reduces as the dimensionality reduces. So the three-dimensional system has highest drag, whereas the system as you go down will have smaller and smaller drags. Now these are the what we call as QR plots, which are second order tensors of vorticity, which are shown here. And if you plot the trace of the quantities as shown here, you obtain, if the system is purely intermittent, you obtain a teardrop shape, and if the system is purely non-intermittent, you obtain a Gaussian-like shape. And we see that as you move down the dimensionality, the system becomes completely non-intermittent. So from three-dimensional system, which is completely intermittent, to completely non-intermittent. And the reason is that there are what we call as vortexes, which are elongated, kind of tubes in the system, vortex tubes, which vanish as you go from the three-dimensional system to smaller system, smaller dimensional system, and hence the stretching of these vortexes also vanishes. I will show you that next. So if you see the vortexes in a purely three-dimensional system, they are very long, as you can see. And if you put a dynamic mask, that is evolve the system, and just a 0.2 fraction less, a 0.02 fraction less, and you see that most of those very long elongated vortex structures have vanished. Whereas if you put a static mask, that is just take a three-dimensional system, static, put a mask and then see what is observed without any time evolution, the static mask does not take away all the structures, as you can see. But dynamic mask completely takes away the structures. So there is a, so this is the reason why we saw those behavior, that from the fully three-dimensional system, which is having a very long vortex and stretched vortex tubes, to almost nil vortex tubes with any elongation. So this is the small scale structure that you see in the 2.5 dimensional systems. That is, there are no large scale structures at all present anymore from the original, say, three-dimensional system. So for this part of the work, the conclusions are that we have now a handle on creating a fractal dimension system where we can switch on or off intermittency. Because DC, the critical dimension, is 2.96. We can either go on this side or that side of 2.96 and see whether we can create intermittency or not. And energy flux is constant. We saw that. And so even though we reduce the number of modes, the energy keeps transferring. So the system is itself turbulent but not intermittent. That is what is the idea. And the compensation of energy spectrum is through that particular power law. And static mass configurations, spectrum recover, but structures don't. And we found this critical dimension. And but what we can say as of now is that the original problem of, say, intermittency is not yet completely understood. But we have now just a handle on how to create and decimate or disturb intermittency. What are we trying to do next? We are trying to understand intermittency in the Fourier domain, but because currently whatever statistical analysis was done was in the spatial domain. But to do, intermittency analysis in Fourier domain is difficult because a scale can be created by many modes. So we don't know how or which scale can be responsible for a particular intermittent event. So that is the difficulty in this particular thing. And we can extend this particular process of decimation to MHD turbulence as well. That is, you can, because the number of parameters are more, we have energy, magnetic energy, kinetic energy, magnetic helicity, and another parameter called kinetic helicity to play with. We can try to introduce a lot of different kinds of decimation processes in the MHD turbulent case. So what does what are the possible outcomes? I would foresee that in near future, Fourier domain analysis of intermittency may not be accomplished, but extending the decimation process to turbulent MHD turbulent flows can give us an understanding of how various physical parameters in the system are related and which parameters are more important than others. Now the work on 3D MHD turbulence. Here the equations that are simulated are as shown here. Here we directly don't use say the diffusive quantities in their normal form, but I use what is known as hyperdiffusivity. So hyperdiffusivity is a numerical concept where you are able to push the noise that is coming in the inertial range towards the dissipation range. So this n represents the level of hyperviscosity. And also in the when I'm working with inverse cascade, the inverse cascade when it reaches the peak of the of any physical quantity, if reaches the boundary, it will start rebounding and creates noise on the in the normal range, spectral range. So what you try to do is you try to put a sink there, which acts only in the extremely large k or extremely small k values, and then remove that effect. So my initial condition is a Gaussian of such kind, and forcing is also of the same kind, random Gaussian. So what I do is here, I work on a regular cubic grid, periodic boundary conditions, pseudo-spectral method as I explained earlier. But here we use a different integration scheme, that is modified leapfrog. And here I do spherical truncation. That here spherical truncation means you take a much larger Fourier domain than necessary, and the errors, numerical errors, will go into the and cut off the unnecessary modes that you don't need. Then the numerical errors will go into those modes, and you retain, for example, a 1024 cube spectrum. You get 512 modes if you can do spherical truncation, and 512 into 2/3, that is about 300 and odd if you do 2/3 aliasing. And we use MPA parallelization. And I worked with magnetic Prandtl number of unity in my earlier work, and we are proposing to work with this particular slide. I will explain later part of the slide. And we see isosurfaces of magnetic field shown there, as shown there. But what are the main results of this work? We saw clear inverse cascade because this is the initial condition. The small green color spectrum that is shown here is the initial condition. And as the time evolves, the clear inverse cascade gets established. And if we don't force the system, but we start with a much larger value of helicities, we do get inverse cascade in a decaying system, it is called. And when you look at the total energies in the system, we see that in the small scales the energies are equiparted, but in the large scales the kinetic energy is less than magnetic energy by a factor of about 10. And when we compensate these spectrum, we see that there is a relation that comes out which is new, that is Ek by Em, and we saw that this gamma is 2 in our case. And this particular relation tells you that the inverse cascade to take place, there should be an interaction between four parameters: magnetic energy, kinetic energy, magnetic helicity, and kinetic helicity. Kinetic helicity, like magnetic helicity, is a volume integral of vorticity dot velocity field. And this particular relation is true in both the cases, that is forced turbulence as well as decaying turbulence. So this particular work questioned the universality of the spectral power, which was always thought to be k power minus 2, but we saw that the spectral power was something like k power minus 3.3 and 3.6 in each of these cases. And so this particular work resulted in a paper called Lack of Universality in MHD Turbulence and Possible Emergence of a New Paradigm. And they quote our work and say that this particular work has now questioned the old ideas of k power minus 2. And so we need to understand why this particular new power laws are emerging. And currently nobody has any answer, but we only know that the power laws are of the order of k power minus 3.3, because there are 3 or 4 papers that were reported, and all of them saw to the power loss to the range of minus 3.3, 3.4 and 3.6. What we saw was 3.3 and 3.6. When we look at the statistical analysis, we do the same structure function analysis, but to the magnetic field here, and also the flatness or kurtosis and the correlation functions, autocorrelation function as defined there, we see that these are the active regions of the sun that are observed through magnetograms in the sun, magnetograms from Earth. And their magnetic fields were at every point were used to construct what are known as the structure functions and then the structure function exponents. And the flatness curves, correlation functions. And we used our data to show that all this is possible through our work, where we started with a forced system and removed the forcing in the middle of the evolution and allowed the system to decay. Then the curves will start here and fall back to these tilted curves. Same is the case when you are having fully forced turbulence, or when the flare is about to come, you see, or flare is still cooking on the sun, you see a flatness curve of that kind, which is shown, which is equal to what we see in our forced case. And when the flare emerges out, we see that the flatness curve becomes like that, which we see in the decaying cases in our case. And also, correlation functions also do the same. Correlation function before and after forcing and decaying. Forcing and decaying. That is when you force the system and you stop the forcing and allow the system to decay, the correlation function falls on this side. Then we saw how much evolution of structures can happen. So these are the extremely small scale structures that we start with, and these are the largest scale structures that we can see in our system. You see here the evolution of such structures from extremely small scales to large scales. And we see that the isosurfaces of magnetic field look like what we call as flux ropes. So they are twisted and turned ropes like thing, and they are called flux ropes, as you can clearly see. And then we saw that there is emergence of large scale structures, but how do large scale structures emerge from small scales? The classic idea is what is known as magnetic reconnection. That is when two counter rotating vertices come close by, they form in a perpendicular plane a current sheet and merge and create a much larger structure. So for example, if you look at the isosurfaces of two counter rotating vertices, these are the isosurfaces of two counter rotating vertices of magnetic field. In the perpendicular plane exactly, you see the current sheet forming there. So there are three fields merged in this particular visualization. So the velocity is at random. It is present every in any present in any and everywhere. Direction is immaterial, but the direction of the current sheet is important because it is exactly perpendicular to this plane. If we can see, it is in the in this particular projection. So the blue color here. So there are two. This is a classical signature of a reconnection region. So there are many such identified reconnection regions. Here, what I did was I took the field, I took the vectors of the field, and then superimposed these two to form this particular figure, and identified where all there are counter-rotating vortices. And one such counter-rotating vortices field I could visualize with all the three fields put in. So we saw the exact signature of reconnection there. But this particular idea of reconnection is purely, as one can see, is a topological phenomenon. Magnetic helicity, if I can go back, is a measure of, as I mentioned, is a measure of linkage and twist, which is again a topological phenomena. These two topological phenomena have never been studied together, although people have known that these two are topological phenomena for I don't know how many years basically. So we want to try and see if using the ideas of computational topology, where we have expertise in our institute, Amit and Jaya. So we are trying to come and collaborate and see if we can identify any measurable quantities to quantify reconnection in this particular domain. So the conclusions are that we studied what we call as inverse cascade of magnetic helicity, and spectral power of magnetic helicity is neither constant nor universal. We found a new relation which helps you understand what is known as alpha quenching, which I have not talked here because it's more involved topic. And this is part of a new paradigm that is emerging, this work. And large scale magnetic structure formation can be explained, and active regions of the sun were modeled to show the relevance of this particular method. And computational topology could be the way out to understand reconnection. So proposed work in this domain is this. There are, as I mentioned earlier, magnetic Prandtl number, which is the ratio of magnetic Reynolds number to kinetic Reynolds number, creates two regimes. One is known as the high magnetic Prandtl number regime, and other is called a low magnetic Prandtl number regime. And in these two cases, there are three important scales to look for, which are viscous scales, resistive scales, and the forcing scale. So these three scales are to be resolved in any simulation that you want to do. And in a high magnetic Prandtl number regime, this is the typical way the scales are arranged. You see the viscous scales greater than the diffusive scales, greater than the forcing scales. Whereas in the low magnetic Prandtl number regime, it is the vice versa. The resistive scales are highest and diffusive scales are second, and the forcing scale, of course, is the largest scale which they force. But now we want to use a different method. We want to force our systems here and see how these scales get evolved. And these simulations are not trivial in nature, because to evolve and clearly resolve these scales has never been done before. So we would want to try and say achieve the Reynolds numbers as shown here. And because the simulations are computationally challenging, we would want to attempt these simulations. Then we would do the statistical analysis, which I already mentioned, PDFs, structure function analysis, kurtosis, correlation functions. But what we would do new here is the topological analysis. In that specifically, we want to try out what is known as most male complex. This particular slide was prepared by Amit. Here we want to identify the singularities, saddles, and maxima using and these are connected using and to understand stable and unstable separatrices. These are the separatrices. So the domain is then separated into quadrangular regions of equivalent gradient flow. That is the idea of Mosmel complex. We want to try this particular method on the magnetic field data and see if we can understand reconnection any better. Also, we want to use second order tensor field topologies. That is, we want to construct covariance tensors on various parameters, including various parameters. We want to include magnetic energy, kinetic energy, magnetic helicity, and kinetic helicity, and create covariance tensors of and then see if we can create or understand the nature of critical points in these and the relations between these four parameters, if they emerge out any better in this method, is what we want to understand. I'm not an expert on this particular topic. I'm yet to understand these. And the possible outcomes of this particular work are that, so we would try to see if we can also put in what is known as cross helicity, that is the interaction helicity, V dot B, integral over the entire volume. That particular work is, again, a new work, which has never been done before. And we would also try to improve the intermittency the statistical tools to help understand better the ideas of intermittency. Topological tools we want to develop and see if we can understand any relation between magnetic helicity and reconnection. And this particular work can also be used to understand low beta plasmas in fusion reactors. So in fusion reactors, they confine plasma using very large magnetic fields, and there the same ideas of what we do here in the simulations could come in handy. So we would want to apply those ideas into the low beta tokamak plasmas. What we have done so far is we had written a project to BRNS, Board for Research in Nuclear Sciences, and got money to the tune of 34.8 lakhs, and we bought a small HPC, high performance computer, and we named it Fusion Turbulence, as you see here. And we did currently, what is the computing performance of the system? We used two compilers, 2013 Intel Parallel Studio and 2018 Parallel Studio, and we obtained for the older compiler about 3.6 teraflops of computing performance and 5.3 teraflops of computing performance for the new compiler. And our code, which is fully parallelized, we used with 32 cores, 64 cores, or 128 cores. We have a total of 160 cores. So we have to use 2 power n because of the Fourier transform involved. So we used 32, 64, and 128, and saw that the time involved reduces, but not linearly as one wanted. The reason being that there is a lot of MPI communication once you start reaching the higher number of cores. So the communication time is getting eaten away, but even then we are getting best performance for 128 cores. That is the current story. FFTW, PFTW and FFTW. But Intel. Yes, I agree. But what in our code, we have written it in such a manner that because of the computational ease, we have written it so that when we divide it into even number of and 2 power n cores, we get the best performance. But if we do it any other way, like for example 160 cores, if I use 160 cores, and then I will have a skewed distribution of the modes. That's fine. inside the system. Now the last topic, I'm trying to venture into trying to understand monsoon modeling. And the equations involved are shown here. First, we have the equation law. So we have the law of conservation of mass, then the law of conservation of momentum with its Coriolis force term, then the conservation of energy, which involves the temperature, and then moisture conservation to understand the humidity conservation in the atmosphere. These equations are not written in the form that are shown here, but they are written for a specific coordinate system. And then to solve this particular system of equations, there's a code called Varsha, which was written in NAL, National Aeronautics Laboratory, in 1960s and 1970s. And it contains 15 modules. The names of the modules are here. I'm yet to understand this particular set of modules. So the idea is that if you want to go one step and in time, you have to probably solve about at least 12 or 13 of these modules. So it's a very complex system. And how it works, if you divide the system into two parts, it has variables which are very specific to this particular system. And you input those variables with a some initial state. You input the boundary conditions and the initial conditions to the forecast model, and the forecast model itself will contain dynamics, which includes advection, diffusion, and other say non-hydrostatic equations. And then there is the input physics, which is coming from radiation, boundary layers, rainfall, surface process, etc. And then it comes here where you see the forecast, whether it is okay, go. If not, go to the diagnostics, what is the problem, then repeat the whole thing. So that is how the system works. And the topics involved are, or what I have to understand still are, the model itself, the code, the cloud modeling, how the clouds are modeled and inputted into this physics, how the convection is modeled, and when will a cloud rain, that is not understood still. And there are ranges. So if, for example, there is some phenomena of El Nino, which affects our monsoon. So there are global linkages, and then there are also local linkages, like a sudden volcano eruption close to Bay of Bengal, anywhere near Indonesia, may trouble the whole monsoon. So then there are mesoscales, which are to the tune of about 500 kilometers. Then there are large scales, thousands of kilometers, and small scales, kilometers range. So the involved scales are also much complicated in this particular system. And I'm trying to venture into this work. As you see, that is the current state me there. And I'm collaborating with scientists from CSIR Fourth Paradigm Institute to understand this particular work, because they have the code now. From NAL, they got the code. And I'm trying to see if I can contribute to this work in near future. So thank you for coming.